If I write here y x minus 1, then what will happen? The line will actually start from minus 1, but the slope will remain the same. All these lines will be parallel to each other. But now if I write an equation, then y is equal to 2x plus 1. What does it mean? It means that the slope is now 2, while the intercept is 1. So the starting point is this one, but the slope is now 2. What does 2 means? Come here. That m equals 2 means that for each value of x, y will have 2 more values. Like if x is 1, this will be 2. If x will be 2, this will be 4, and so on. So our straight line will actually now will no more be parallel to these lines, but it will change and it will become something like this. That from here I will change the slope of it. It will be somehow like this. That for each value of x, it will go 2 values of y. So when the slope changes, the straight line inclination change, but its shape remains the same. It will be a straight line. So what I will call this line? This line I will call that this is having 0 slope, x-axis. Why? Because on this line the x is having values but the y value is 0, or on this line. So this is called the slope 0 line. What about this line? This is called the slope 1 line. The x and y values are the same. What about this line? On this line, the y value is changing but the x value remains 0. So something divided by 0 will give you undefined. You don't know, it's the value is too huge. So 0 slope, then 1 slope, and then undefined slope. Right? So you are clear with this, that in a straight line equation, this is the independent variable, this is the dependent variable, and this one is the intercept, which is the y intercept. Because this c is coming here, it will become y minus c. And this m is called the slope of that line. Clear? So you are clear about the straight line, that how it changes its inclination. The shape will be a straight line. This is a straight line. This is a straight line. All of these are straight lines. So now we will come to our laws. Actually, this thing will remain. Okay? So, now we come to our equation. Let me first discuss the equation and then we will move how we should write this equation. The very first thing, V is equal to IR, which we call Ohm's law. Actually, this is not a law, because law is having some other requirements. This is actually an empirical relation. Right? This is an empirical relation. Why the law is actually, the Ohm's law is J equals sigma e, where j is the current density, sigma is the conductivity of a material, and E is the applied electric field. So this is actually that J is proportional to the electric field, and then J is equal to a constant and the electric field, and this constant is actually dependent on the material, which we call conductivity. Which we call conductivity of a material. And this is equal to 1 over rho, where rho is called resistivity of a material. Clear? Rho is called the resistivity of a material. Now, when I write that J is equal to 1 over rho in the electric field. Now, here J is equal to the current per unit area which is perpendicular to it. We call the cross-sectional area. Then 1 over rho in electric field, I can simply state in limited conditions is this is the voltage per unit length, the potential per unit length. This is a limited equation. This is also not true everywhere. So I can write that I over A is equal to 1 over rho, and this is V over L. And then I can write that rho L over A means rho L I multiplied and I moved it here, and then A and I, and this is equal to V. And I define this quantity, which is rho L over A, is the resistance of a material. V. This implies V equals IR. Now here we will have to distinguish between the rho and the R. Rho is called resistivity of a material. And this is the intrinsic property of a material. You can recognize a material from this property. While R is not the intrinsic property of a material, this is called the geometrical property of a material. Why geometrical? Because you see here that R is equal to rho L over A. Rho is the material property, but length and area are actually geometrical properties. The same material, if you change its length or you change its area, then its resistance will become different, but its resistivity will remain the same. Resistivity only depends on temperature. With temperature, the resistivity will change. So we are not discussing that situation. As long as you are at standard temperature, the resistivity of two materials cannot be the same. But two materials can have the same resistance, right? Because it's a geometrical property, you can change their geometry. So this is the intrinsic property of a material. And R is the geometrical property of a material. Now today our job is not actually to discuss this thing more, but just to tell you the difference between the resistivity and the resistance. Because our job is to decide whether to write it like this or like this. So now come to our equation. Now we will have to decide between this V and this I. Right? Between this V and this I. If I write here in this equation that Y is proportional to X, if I ignore this C, that C is equal to 0, then Y is proportional to X and Y is equal to some constant and X, and this implies that Y is equal to MX. This constant is actually M. So now I will have to write my equation in that form, Y proportional to X means the dependent is proportional to the independent. What is dependent and independent here? We give voltage and we get current. It is not like this that you give current and you get voltage. So it means that when I write the equation Y is proportional to X, this implies that the dependent variable is actually I, and this is proportional to the independent. Then this implies that this proportionality can be converted into an equation with a constant. What should be this constant? Now, the nature of this constant we don't know what it should be. The equation is telling us, that this constant is actually 1 over r. Otherwise you cannot get the equation. But how? Why we will write this thing is 1 over r? Why not r? So for that we will have to come back to our equation again, means our plot again, and let's say we do plot again here our plot here, and this is our dependent axis and this is the independent one. And now this one is V and this one is I. Let's say I discuss the V first response, which is n equal to 1. What is n equal to 1? Means for one unit of V, which is 1 volt, let's say 1 ampere current is produced, because you are measuring this thing in volts and you are measuring this thing in amperes. So if I plot a straight line here and this is slope equal to 1, this line is slope equal to 1. The slope is 1 here because X and Y are the same. What does this mean? This means for 1 volt, you are getting 1 ampere current, right? And what about this line, M equal to 0, slope 0 line? Slope 0 lines means that for any value of voltage, you are not getting any current, right? And this is slope undefined, the huge. For no value of voltage, you are having tremendous amount of current. Clear? Okay. So where our Ohm's law actually lies, we will have to decide that thing. We know that Ohm's law is for ordinary conductors. And ordinary conductors are that you give more voltage and you get less current. So what is that range? This line is actually called ideal insulator. Right? M equal to 0 is, this is ideal insulator. There are no free electrons. Whatever voltage you give to this one, you will get the ideal insulator as a dielectric. What about this one? You give 1 volt, you get 1 ampere. This will be ideal conductor. And then this range, less voltage, more current, somehow superconductor, right? This is somehow a superconductor. Where we are in ordinary conductors, which are not insulators and which are not ideal conductors. So the area in which we are is actually this one, in which Ohm's law is valid. And in this, N is equal to less than 1.